Welcome to today's episode of the Narratives of Grace, the Pastor's Corner. Today, Pastor Dennis and I are discussing the book of Psalms. This is probably one of the most famous books, but I think it's one of the most misunderstood as well.
Yeah, and it's quoted a lot. It's we return to it often, but it is something that there are a lot of different ways that people look at it. There's some prophecy in there. There's a lot of worship. Mm-hmm. There's plenty of theology in there. It's so good. It's so rich. It's huge. There's a lot to look at. But yeah, it's something that is easily misunderstood.
And I think it's often misinterpreted because there is so much. And it seems to us that there's no connection from one to the next. It kind of seems like a hymnal where this one was written in 1500 and this one was written in 1900 and by completely different people in different countries.
Yeah, it can definitely seem that way. And understanding, you know, well, this is a psalm by David. This is a psalm by Asaph. This is a psalm, you know, where we don't know who the author is. And it's hard to see that, but knowing, you know, there's a reason for the structure. There's a reason, you know, you have different divisions within the Psalms. You have like the Psalms of Ascent. You have, you know, some of David's imprecatory Psalms. And so you can kind of see there is some level of division there. There is a thought process mm-hmm. as to how it was compiled. But it reminds me of, you know, Proverbs and just it can, if you're not careful and if you're not going deep into it, it can seem like just a random collection of wise sayings. Well, is this just a random collection of songs? No, it's not random. You know, God and his sovereignty and the way that he's allowed scripture to persevere, there is a set order to things.
Well, and I think that comparison to hymns, a hymnal, is actually pretty right on with the book of Psalms mm-hmm. because one, it is a book of music. They were meant to be sung. They're kind of more challenging to sing in English because of translation stuff, but I still think we need to be singing them more. Mm-hmm. And I have another book that I'm going to mention a little bit later about that. But these weren't written in order. They weren't written at the same time period. They weren't even written in the same place completely.
Right.
But they were organized. And mm-hmm. it's thought that one of the prophets, which one is escaping me at the moment, but one of the prophets and scribes actually put the book together. And he would have probably written a few of the psalms that connected it, mm-hmm. Including the first psalm.
Yeah, and I think it's important for us to understand there's nothing in scripture by accident.
Yeah.
And so when something seems random, we need to understand God has a purpose for it. Mm-hmm. And we have scripture the way that we do for a reason. You know, I think that God, through his providence, has given us scripture. And obviously we know that, you know, men got together and determined, all right, this is the order that we're going to set things. And there's reasons for that. And maybe in a later podcast, we can talk about, you know, how did we get the canon, your canon of scripture, and what was the selection process for determining which things go in and which things stay out? You know, we can talk about all of that. So, but it's important at surface level for us to understand there's no accidents. God is sovereign. So there's nothing that happens where God is like, oh, well, that was a happy accident. Yeah. Or the converse of that would be, you know, there's no point in history that God was ever seated on his throne thinking like, ah, oh, did not see that coming. You know, that doesn't happen. And well, that includes scripture and mm-hmm. the formation of his word. As he inspired people to write, you know, over 40 different authors through a period of over 4,000 years, we have these 66 books. Well, none of it is there by accident. None of it is completely random. There is a reason for why it was written, why we have what we have. We have what God wants us to have.
Well, yeah, and with this book of Psalms, the book of songs, it is, they are meant for worship. That's mm-hmm. why they were written. And I think sometimes we'll read the Psalms of Lament and things like that and be like, oh, we don't do things like that in worship, but we should.
Well, absolutely. And this isn't the only place you see songs. You know, I mean, I think of Song of Solomon, you know, and that is a lengthy song. It's kind of like, And I don't mean this, you know, in a derogatory way, but it's kind of like Scripture's version of like the wreck of the Edmund Fitzgerald, that song that just never seems to end. It's a very long song, and there's a reason for that. Mm-hmm. But, you know, Paul wrote in song. There are different prophets that included songs, and songs of lament are a thing.
Yeah.
And as you said, that is something we should do more often. When we look around, and I don't want to get off on too much of a rabbit trail, but as we look around at our society, there should be some lamenting on our part over mm-hmm. the nature of things. I just watched a video this morning where there was the commentator was just going completely off on a recent decision that was made, and it's just so sad to listen. I'm not going to mention what it was, but it's just so sad to see his anger and frustration and knowing he's hurting, he's struggling, it's real, but recognizing I don't think that we're thinking through things. The mm-hmm. reason he was so frustrated is because of a decision that was made, and just instantly it's like, well, it was only made because of this.
Yeah.
And it's like, well, no, you know, we need to take a step back, but I almost don't blame him. You know, people are hurting. There should be some lamenting for what's going on in our nation right now.
No, there should be, but I think the Psalms are a good example for that too, because anytime we look at and read through one of the Psalms of Lament, with one exception, there's only one exception to this, is that the psalmist is working through something. So they don't just get angry and stay there. Again, with one exception, there's one that ends a little sad. I believe, if I'm remembering correctly, it's number 80. But they're working through the aspect. Psalm 22 is why have you forsaken me? But hope comes in the morning is the end of it. And I might be misquoting the end of that. That might be a different one, but essentially that is how it ends. It might be different words, but that is the idea of it. But it's also interesting to see that this book of Psalms, the book of music for worship, is the longest book in the Bible. Not just in terms of chapter, but in terms of just pure verses, it is longer than any other book in Scripture. There are more verses in the book of Psalms than in all of the epistles put together. And that's kind of, I think that goes to show not that it's the most important, but that it is important, that it isn't just a book of nice stuff.
Right. Well, and I think it's important, you know, what you said, that the psalmist is working through things, because we definitely see that, I think, probably the most in David, where you'll have one psalm from David where, you know, God, your love endures forever. You're amazing. I love you so much. You're the greatest thing ever. And then the very next psalm is like, do you hate me or something? Yeah. Like, what's going on here? And then the next psalm is like, dude, you need to kill this dude. Like, he won't leave me alone. And he's stopping your work from being done. So, like, you want to help me out here? And then next thing you know, it's like, God, your patience is so great. And I'm glad that you don't, you know, you're slow to anger and you're quick to love. And you see these different aspects of the Psalms. And like you said, David is working through things. We have Psalms of David where he's Psalms of repentance, you know, where he's crying out to God because of his sin, where he's rejoicing in God's grace because he knows he's been forgiven of his sins. There's so much, and the book of Psalms is really worth studying.
Yeah, well, and one of the other interesting things is how we get this, because I mentioned that, you know, the one of the prophets, I want to say it was Ezra, but I can't remember for sure. Or most likely organized it. We don't actually see anywhere in Scripture where it says this person did this. Other places we see that kind of a thing, but we don't really see that with the Psalms.
Mm-hmm.
But it's also interesting to see that the book is divided up into five other books. There's five books of the Psalms.
Right.
Each book ends with a doxology, meaning a verse of praise. So there's just a few random psalms that will end, and it almost seems random, but it's obviously not from everything that we've said so far. But the first book ends with Psalm 41, and the end of Psalm 41 is praise be to the Lord, the God of Israel, from everlasting to everlasting. Amen and amen. And that's pretty much how all of the five books end, with that. God, your God, you're the Lord forever. Mm-hmm. They all say it in different ways, but there's almost like a formulaic structure to it.
Mm-hmm.
But it's also interesting when we look at it, because the first book actually doesn't seem to start with Psalm 1. It seems to start with Psalm 3. 1 and 2 almost seem like an introduction.
Right.
When we read through it, and we kind of see the high points of the book in that. But when we read through these, we should be looking at them for their range of emotion. Calvin said that the Psalms are the anatomy of the soul, because they all express everything that we feel. It's not just happy clappy. Like we've already said, like we need to be looking at those laments more. We need to be looking at the fear, the frustration, the even sometimes the anger. My God, why have you forsaken me? I don't know if anyone can read that and not feel anger in it. But
at the very least, just profound sadness.
Yeah. And it's just such an amazing thing, but it's also amazingly beautiful poetry. And when we look at it like that, it changes a lot when we don't just see it as old stuff, but as actual poetry, and we read it that way, we see something profound in it.
Well, I think we all look at things differently. So when we approach different books, like we understand if it's historical narrative, we understand we're going to look at it as such. We understand, or at least we should understand, the difference between something that's descriptive and something that's prescriptive. Mm-hmm. We look at prophecy and understanding, you know, this is something that's foretold, this is something that's going to happen, and much of biblical prophecy is there. Mm-hmm. And we can look at how it was fulfilled, and so we look back and see like, oh, okay, well, this is what was said 700 years later, so-and-so showed up, and this is what was done. And so we see that. But coming from your background, being mostly in, you know, worship and worship studies, you know, how do you, when you come to the book of Psalms, how do you approach the Psalms?
One of the things is that I make sure that I don't just take excerpts from the Psalms to fit, but I try and use entire ones. So in our worship,
you don't just take one verse and leave it?
No, take things out of context, and it's an interesting concept there, but
sorry,
which doesn't mean that we can't quote just one line. I mean, in the New Testament, actually, the book of Psalms is the most quoted book,
right?
And we do see constantly them quoting one verse, so it's not to say that we can't, but we should be looking at them entirely.
Well, normally when a biblical author quotes one of the Psalms, it's because it fits within the context of what they're already writing.
Yeah.
Like when we throw up a verse on our Facebook page or whatever, if it's by itself, there's no context. And so we need to be careful about that. But yeah, so as you were saying, sorry.
No, and so one of the things is that our worship time, our worship music needs to be focused on God, not on us.
True story.
The few times that the Psalms talk about us, it's in what God has done.
Mm-hmm.
It's not, I'm happy because you did this. It might be my soul cried out because you've saved me. But that's pretty much it.
Well, that's like the number escapes me, but the Psalm that talks about, you know, you have fearfully and wonderfully made me, mm-hmm. you know, and, you know, praising God. It's not, you know, you made me awesome, and so therefore I am awesome. It's, you are awesome because you made me.
Yeah.
And so, like you said, the focus is always on God. And I think it's important that we see that, because as we talk about worship, and there've been podcasts and different conversations and millennium-minute videos and whatnot, and, you know, even sermons, you know, talking about worship. And there's been one thing that's more than anything else that's consistent in all of our conversations about worship, and that is the focus is always on God.
Mm-hmm.
We are not the audience. And so we are not the audience of the Psalms. The Psalms were not written to make us feel good about ourselves.
Mm-hmm.
They were written so that we would understand God's goodness, His grace, His love, His mercy, for His love endures forever, His mercies renew every morning. Both concepts that the Psalms teach us about, but the focus is always on Him.
Mm-hmm. Well, and that's even so. One of the most common phrases throughout the book of Psalms is blessing, mm-hmm. or words, I should say, not phrases, but blessed, blessing. It always is a source of God. it always comes from God. It's always to God when it talks about, and there's two or three different Hebrew words toward that. But when it focuses toward God, it's almost ascribing worth. So it's not that we give him worth, but that we're ascribing him worth, which is part of what worship is. Mm-hmm. But when he blesses us, he is giving us worth. It's more of active, otherwise. And I believe typically those are two different words. I don't know enough Hebrew to actually talk to that other than I know that it's there. But the book of Psalms in that way, we need to see that it is a book ultimately of blessing. But in that, I mean that it is a book that God blesses us by giving us these things and reminding us these things, but that we bless him in terms of, we worship him fully. Mm-hmm. And it is interesting. One of the things that I think we don't know with hymns is that when we see who wrote a hymn, they're not the one that wrote the music. They wrote the text. Mm-hmm. Isaac Watts wasn't a musician. He didn't write. He wrote these hymns, meaning he wrote the text. And if we read those texts in and of themselves, they're amazingly beautiful. Sometimes they're better without the music. That's a whole nother conversation, but it's the same with the Psalms. We should be reading them in their entirety for what they're saying. Now, some of them are harder to read in their entirety in one sitting. Psalm 19 is the longest single chapter of the entire scripture.
Yeah, 119.
Yeah. Oh yeah. Sorry.
You're good.
119. 19 is not long. I actually think it's one of the shorter ones if I remember correctly, but
right.
119 is like 100 and some verses.
So what do you have? 119 is the longest, 117 is the shortest, mm-hmm. and then 118 is the like exact middle of the Bible.
Yeah.
And so, you know, there's an infographic about that out there. But so you have some short ones, some long ones. We've already talked about what the Psalms are. We talked about what the focus is. But you had mentioned something in our conversation prior to this, and something you're working through and something you're learning. So describe, you know, there's different ways that we view the Psalms, mm-hmm. And then there's different structures within the Psalms. And so you were telling me about the three pillars of the Psalms. Mm-hmm. So would you talk about that?
So I'll, before that, one quick thing that makes that make more sense is that every other book in the scriptures we see is one of two things. They're either historic or they're making an argument. And, you know, we have different categories, you know, prophecy and stuff like that within the historic, but those are still making arguments in some ways. But we don't look at the Psalms that way, except we should, because it is a book of prophecy. It is making arguments. It's trying to teach us something. There's something called the moral imagination, which is basically how our mental life should be shaped by scripture, by God, by whatever. And the more we read in philosophy, it is going to be shaped. It's a matter of what direction. Mm-hmm. But that is the purpose of the book of Psalms, ultimately, is to shape that moral imagination. And it is through these three things. These three things are the arguments we see throughout. I say that the book of the first book in this book of Psalms starts with three, because one and two are like an introduction. And they make this argument within the two of them. But the first is that the first theme, the first major thing that we see is that the Lord reigns. God is king. He is sovereign. He is above all else. And we really need to hold on to that. The second is that the Lord has already determined the destiny of those that are blessed and wicked. Now, who is which one? You can make arguments, and how they get put into those categories, we can make arguments, but the destiny of those two groups is already determined. Mm-hmm. And it's interesting if you do a word study of bless and wicked or evil in scripture and the way that each one is, but in the book of Psalms, but it is pretty much that God blesses people and the wicked he turns away. But the third one within that is that blessed are those who take refuge in him. And that is obviously fulfilled in Christ. Christ is seen in the Psalms, both in terms of God's grace, but also in the coming Messiah. But we see it fulfilled in him. He quoted the Psalms constantly. The Psalms were quoted about him constantly. Mm-hmm. But Isaac Watts actually did something in one of his hymnals called He Christianized the Hymns, or the Psalms, excuse me. And basically the full book title is the Psalms of David Imitated. So he took all of them and put the different themes of where we see Christ. And we see that in a lot of his different hymns. O 4,000 Tongues to Sing, we see that idea of crying out and calling out to Christ.
Mm-hmm.
and different things like that. But those are really the central idea and argument of the Psalms, is that God is king. The destiny of everyone is determined, whether it's the blessed or the wicked. And those that are take refuge in him are the blessed.
True. Yeah, no, I think everything you're saying is fantastic. And I think it's important for us to understand that. You know, this isn't just a book we turn to when we're looking for something nice to say. And, and I think we need to get away from that mentality that, you know, the Psalms are there, but they're just kind of there. No, there's, as we said already, there's a lot there for us to learn from. And as you said, it's, you know, seeing Christ in the Psalms is not that difficult.
No.
You know, his crucifixion was detailed in the Psalms. Mm-hmm. We knew exactly what was going to happen to him because it was already explained. We knew, you know, about the not a bone would be broken because that was described in the Psalms, you know. And so there's many different things that the Psalms are there for, and it's not just... they're not just a song. They're not there just for, you know, emotional enjoyment. They're there because they are true worshipful passages. They're there to help us to understand God more fully. And it was done in a poetic way. It was done as, you know, we have to understand in biblical hermeneutics and understanding how we're going to interpret things. You know, you interpret poetry slightly different than you are, you know, some of the other aspects of scripture, but you can look at history, you can look at prophecy, which, as you said, is part of history. But you can look at, you know, historical narrative, prophecy, you look at imperatives, you look at, you know, things that are prescribed for us, the things that we must do, but then also poetry is there for us. We see that, and the poetry is not just there in the Psalms. You know, Job is described as poetry.
Mm-hmm.
And so there are different poetic books as well, and it's worth us diving deeper.
Yeah.
And I know of pastors who they go on these long series through different books of the Bible, and then in between the series they'll take a handful of Psalms that fit together, and they'll go through these, you know, several chapters and spend a month or two working through these ideas, and then they'll return back to a new book study or they're going through a new significant passage. But I think that it would be a mistake to neglect really any part of scripture. I think it would be a mistake to neglect the Psalms.
Mm-hmm.
But I like the idea that the three pillars, the three things that we're seeing in the Psalms, and especially that third one, blessed are all those who take refuge in him, and knowing, you know, where does our help come from? Well, we know the answer to that because the Psalms tell us.
Yeah, and it is important, and it is difficult because you and I both preach through books. That's how we see things, and occasionally we'll take steps out of that for different reasons. When the lockdown started, I preached out of Matthew I used the Luke text, I think, but the calming the storm,
mm-hmm.
And different things like that. The Psalms are a little trickier to do that with, since there's 150 of them. And there's some that are like 119 that are basically 22, 23 different Psalms all put together. That's a podcast in and of itself, is explaining that one. But I think one of the important things is to see is that Psalms were written for worship. Mm-hmm. That is literally their purpose. That doesn't mean they're meant just to be sung, and since we don't sing them anymore, that we don't use them. In fact, there are books that make it possible to sing the Psalms more easily. I talk about the regulative view of worship, which is what I hold to, but I hold to a more liberal side of it. But the really conservative side of it says that we should only be singing the Psalms and worship. And I'm reading a book that makes that argument. I don't agree with it still. He hasn't convinced me. But there are things called metrical psalters, which make it so that we can sing the Psalms more readily.
Right.
And I kind of want to use it from time to time in our worship service. But this one is called the metrical psalter, the book of Psalms set to meter for singing by Julian Timothy Tennant. And basically it rewords some of the stuff to make it even meters, like all of the hymns. And it's really cool because it gives hymn tunes that fit that psalm.
Oh, that's good.
They don't always fit like feeling wise.
Yeah.
Like there was one that I sang and I was like, this feels wrong. It fits the meter, but not the mood.
Right.
But something like that for family worship is a really good thing because they give the tune names, which is what I'm more familiar with, but then it gives the more familiar name, like St. Anne. Most people don't know what that means, but it's O God, Our Help in Ages Past.
Mm-hmm.
And so it's a really cool book, and I suggest looking into that for family worship times.
Yeah, I think if you can find something that helps you to sing the songs as a family, that's certainly helpful, but... Also, things that help you to understand the Psalms. Mm-hmm. You know, there are people who have a set reading plan that they read, you know, one proverb per day and typically five Psalms per day. And you know, there's a section of the Psalms that's a chore. Mm-hmm. Not in a negative way. It's just going to take you time. But, you know, that's one thing. So I'd encourage you, if nothing else, read it, you know.
Yeah.
But don't read it just to read it. You know, as you have time, dive a little bit deeper.
Mm-hmm.
Search these out. There's so much to glean from the Psalms, and there's so much to learn and to apply to your faith. And you know, if you're struggling, there's a Psalm that helps you to identify with the psalmist who is struggling. If you're rejoicing in God's goodness, there are plenty of psalms that help you to rejoice in God's goodness. If you're just honoring him because of his magnificence and just how incredible he is, there are psalms of ascent that talk about that. You know, if you're having a difficult time in any number of ways, again, there are psalms for that. There's so much there for all of us.
Mm-hmm. One other little interesting thing, and this is an interesting aspect of it. We know that chapters and things like that weren't put in the original manuscripts. We don't have Romans with Paul writing chapter one. The Psalms are the same way because most of the time they are separate because they were a separate poem,
mm-hmm.
but that wasn't always the case. So actually some of the Psalms look like they're supposed to be one Psalm. Which changes some, that doesn't change any of the meanings, but it changes some of the flow and thought of it.
Right.
But one of the interesting ones is Psalm 1 and 2.
Mm-hmm.
They seem like they're supposed to be one thing. And when we read them together, we really see a broader picture. We see those three things when we read those two together. And we see that throughout the different aspects of that. When we read the two different ones together that are look like they're supposed to be together.
Right.
But it's good to talk about the Psalms like this from time to time. It's good to dive into them. I'm hoping to preach through a few of the Psalms later this year after I finish 1 Timothy. Spend some time in the Old Testament texts and see what the Psalms tell us, not just for worship, not just for our feeling, but what they point to in the Messiah. It's an important thing. Like you said, there's a lot of prophecy of Christ in the Psalms, and mm-hmm. a lot of times we just miss it. Because it's poetry. It's not supposed to be taken literally. Well, right. But it's a little bit more complicated than that.
Yeah, it's not as simple as just, you know, one pithy statement and you're good. You know, there's more nuance there that you got to work through. But really, there's so much of Scripture that's like that. You know, I think arguments could be made that some of the Psalms fit together. I do know that, you know, the Old Testament was canonized and you know, by the time of Jesus and the mm-hmm. disciples, you know, they did understand, you know, the sections of the Old Testament, and they had the law and then they had the prophets. And so they understood the different sections because it was broken down by that point. But it is worth looking into that. And I think there are different ways to study the Psalms.
Mm-hmm.
There are different ways to look at, like, hey, right now I'm going to do a study on, you know, the imprecatory Psalms. And I want to understand, where was David's head at when he was working through his, and where was his heart coming from? You know, is he just a vengeful dude, or is he, you know, what is his goal? No, there's truth in that. And there's a reason why he prayed those things, and why he was singing out to God and calling upon him to help him and to give assistance. But then there's also the Psalms of Ascent, which typically are used, you know, for calls to worship. Yeah. The Psalms of Ascent are wonderful for opening up a worship service with one of the Psalms. Mm-hmm. And, you know, one of my favorite passages is when, you know, and David said, David was glad when they said, "Let us go into the house of the Lord." Mm-hmm. And, you know, and I'm glad, especially in shutdowns and COVID, you know, it's, I understand that a little bit more.
Yeah. Oh, yeah.
You know, let us go to the house of the Lord. We can go, like, it's open. Let's do this. You know, let's gather together, sing his praises, sing the Psalms, and serve him and make his name known among the land. And that's why we exist, is to glorify him. And the Psalms help us to do that.
Amen. As we end today's podcast, I'm going to read Psalms 1 and 2. Reading two Psalms, it's not very long, the two of them together. But I think, one, it's good to see these two and how they connect. But it's also seeing these three pillars, the ideas of that the Lord reigns, the Lord has destined the destination of the blessed and the wicked, and that those who take refuge in him are the blessed. But so if you have a copy of the scriptures, I'm reading out of the NIV, which is uncommon for me, but I think it's a good translation with these. But Psalms 1 and 2 say, "Blessed is the man who does not walk in the counsel of the wicked, or stands in the way of sinners, or sit in the seat of mockers. But his delight is in the law of the Lord, and on his law he meditates day and night. He is like a tree planted by streams of water, which yields its fruit in season, and whose loaf does not wither. Whatever he does prospers. Not so the wicked. They are like the chaff that the wind blows away. Therefore the wicked will not stand in judgment, nor sinners in the assembly of the righteous. For the Lord watches over the way of the righteous, but the way of the wicked will perish. Why do the nations conspire, and the people plot in vain? The kings of the earth take their stand, and the rulers gather together against the Lord and against his anointed one. Let us break their chains, they say, and throw off their fetters. The one enthroned in heaven laughs. The Lord scoffs at them. Then he rebukes them in his anger and terrifies them in his wrath, saying, I have installed my king on Zion, my holy hill. I will proclaim the decree of the Lord. He said to me, you are my son today. I have become your father. Ask of me, and I will make the nations your inheritance. The ends of the earth are your possession. You will rule them with an iron scepter. You will dash them in pieces like pottery. Therefore, you kings, be wise. Be warned, you rulers of the earth. Serve the Lord with fear and rejoice with trembling. Kiss the Son, lest he be angry, and you will destroy in your way, for his wrath can flare up in any moment. Blessed are all who take refuge in him." Thanks be to God.
Beautiful. I think, you know, and there's so much just like that that we can learn from. And as you said, all three of those pillars are there that we can see. The way that God interacts with his creation, bringing about his own glory. Again, there's just so much for us to learn. It's fantastic.
Amen. Let's end with a word of prayer.
Let's pray. Father, I thank you for your goodness. Father, there's so much in the Psalms that remind us of your goodness, that remind us of just your grace and your love and your mercy, your kindness. Father, we know that, and we've mentioned this many times in different avenues, but your scripture tells us, Father, that your kindness is meant to bring us to repentance. We see your kindness on display. We see your power on display. We see your love in the way that you shield and protect those who follow you. We see that on display all throughout the Psalms. But we also see that there are people with legitimate questions. There are legitimate fears. There are legitimate hardships and hurts and struggles that they bring to you in the Psalms. And you respond. You respond in your goodness. You respond in your kindness. You respond in your love. And Father, we're reminded that because of who you are, your mercy endures forever. So Lord, for each person who's listening and for even Pastor Kaleb and myself, Father, help us to continue to be rejuvenated, our faith to be renewed, our strength to be restored in what we understand the Psalms to be teaching us. Father, help us to learn from these. Help us to sing these out to you. Help us to remind you, not that you need us to, but that you call us to remind you of your goodness, of your promises, of your strength, of your love and your mercy. And Father, we see all of this in the Psalms. Help us to never forget just how much meat there is for us to consume in your scripture, and so much growth that is there for us, just waiting for us to study, waiting for us to learn. Father, may you impress upon our hearts a desire to really dig deep into the Psalms, into the songs that remind us of just who you truly are. So, Father, we ask you to give us a good day and bring us back to a place where we can listen again next week, that you would be glorified and honored and we'd be strengthened and edified. We pray all this in your Son's precious and holy name. Amen.
Amen. Thank you for joining us today for this episode of the Narratives of Grace podcast. I pray that this look into the Psalms was beneficial for everyone in seeing the true nature of this book and everything that it has to hold, or at least the beginning of that. If you have any questions or comments about this or any other episode, please email us at pastor@mbaptist.org. And you can email us there if you have any questions or comments that you would like us to address on a future episode. For any prayer requests, please email us at prayer@mbaptist.org. We want to be praying with and for each and every one of you, whether or not you're a member of our church. For more information on Mililani Baptist Church, please visit our website at mbaptist.org or follow us on social media and YouTube. Thank you for joining us today, and we hope that you'll join us again next time.